he who has thirsted knows the value of water, said the English poet Lord Byron. More and more countries now find themselves with too little fresh water, and the world's need for water is doubling every 21 years. But there is no more fresh water now than there was when civilization first began. Many areas will suffer a water shortage. What is more, in many places, such water as there is so polluted that far from being the water of life, it's closer to being the water of death. The Earth is rightly known as the Blue Planet. But if all the world's water were in a bathtub, the fresh water available in any given year would barely fill a teaspoon. The uneven distribution of this water has made the United Nations talk about the danger of future water wars. In this program, we shall first look at the water crisis that threatens that city of hotels and casinos, Las Vegas, in the USA. We shall sail up the Nile, a mighty river but a bone of contention, from Egypt to the Great Lakes of Uganda and Ethiopia. And we shall look in on the oldest functioning court in Europe, a water tribunal in Spain. And on a town at the edge of the Oman desert, where farmers hold auctions to portion out what little water there is. The rain-soaked coast of Norway is a good place to start. Here are two things worth thinking about. Norway has an abundance of water, but two of this country's most serious domestic disputes since the Second World War have been conflicts over the use of fresh water. Secondly, the word rival comes from the Latin rivalis, meaning one person having water rights to the same stream as another. So join me on a journey to some of the places where the rivalry over fresh water is a ticking time bomb. Driving down the strip in Las Vegas is like driving past a display of postmodernism. Totally lacking in aesthetic charm, it may be, but it is extremely fascinating. The city claws its way upwards like some gigantic exotic plant of steel and concrete, reaching for the sky as though its nourishment came from the stars. Little more than a dusty shopping place a few decades ago, Las Vegas has been transformed into the world's entertainment and gambling mecca, a garish, neon-lit urban paradise where Elvis held his farewell concert and where Tyson bit off Holyfield's ear. I wouldn't sleep a minute away. Oh, there's blackjack and poker and the roulette wheel. But in Las Vegas, the very center of show and illusion, the biggest illusion of all, must be the belief that the city can continue to romp and splash in water at will. Las Vegas, Viva Las Vegas, with your neon flashing and your one-armed bandits crashing, all those hopes down the drain. Viva Las Vegas, turning day into nighttime, turning night into daytime if you see it. Here, water flows even more freely than it does on the Scandinavian rain coast, and the amount consumed per capita is actually higher. After all, the people who throng the casinos and luxury hotels do not come to scrimp on water in the fountains and swimming pools or in their drinks. The surfeit of water emerges as a triumphant and presumptuous token of the belief that nature has been overcome. But Las Vegas is tightly trapped in what might well be called the jaws of a water vice. The consumption of water per head is one of the highest in the world, yet the city is built on sand and surrounded by desert. Its numerous fountains, golf courses, and swimming pools conceal but cannot alter the fact that the city's water resources are drastically overexploited. Las Vegas is located in one of the most arid regions of the driest state in the whole of the USA. It was the Hoover Dam and the taming of the Colorado River that gave the impetus to the city's unprecedented growth. Today, the river is regulated to the maximum. There's no more water to be got from it, yet more and more people are asking more and more of it. It enables people to savor the thrill of rafting through the Grand Canyon. And it provides water for canals that irrigate date farms and vineyards hundreds of kilometers distant in California. In Las Vegas, this river provides the ice for cooling drinks. In Nevada, it's a fisherman's delight. And the 25 million people in the seven states through which it flows all want more water. But there is no more. Many years ago, speaking of the western United States, Mark Twain declared, "Whiskey is for drinking, water is for fighting over." He was a wise man. Water shortages are increasing, and on the horizon, many potential conflicts are looming. The river is currently being so heavily exploited that in normal years, no water from it reaches the sea. Outside Las Vegas, gigantic plants have been built to divert water from the Colorado River to the city. The maximum amount permissible is prescribed by law. And as everyone wants more water, Las Vegas's pleas for extra fall on stony ground. Pending further developments, the city has turned to groundwater. The local water banks, the reservoirs laid down by nature over millions of years, are being depleted at an alarming rate. Meanwhile, Las Vegas continues to expand more rapidly than any other city in America. Water consumption must be curtailed and the price of water increased. But who is going to do with less, and how are reductions to be effected? And what about agriculture in the valley? Ought priority to be accorded to the hotels or to residents? And what about all the lawns and golf courses? The situation is highly critical and contentious. A former governor of Arizona once declared that Las Vegas was stealing water at gunpoint. Las Vegas was planned and has expanded as though its water resources were inexhaustible. It may prove a costly illusion. In the casinos, millions of dollars are gambled away every evening. The economy is not only post-industrial, it functions as if natural resources no longer meant anything. Money changes hands fast, but water cannot be changed so easily. For Las Vegas cannot rely on Lady Luck to save it from its looming water crisis. There's no business like show business, they say. But what if the whole show proves to be built on a level of water consumption which cannot be sustained in the long run? Admittedly, one can win a lot of money here in Vegas, but no one can live on dollars alone. The clincher, the decisive game, the one that will decide the city's future, is not being played at a table in a casino, but around a negotiating table and on the drawing boards of water engineers. Las Vegas illustrates what is a global problem, the struggle for enough fresh water. To avoid conflicts, authorities seek to conserve water, to price it more realistically, and to create stable regulatory frameworks. The United Nations has warned against future water wars. Some argue that this fear is based on a myth. But to prevent it becoming a reality, cooperation is needed, since more than half the world's population live in international river basins. We are bound for Uganda and Lake Victoria, for the Sudan and the Sud, the world's biggest swamp, and for the Blue Nile, where it comes sweeping down from the Ethiopian highlands. Our brief is to study the very complicated hydropolitical history of one of the mightiest rivers in the world, the Nile. Gazing at the beautiful river flowing out of the desert as the sun rises over Upper Egypt, it's easy to understand that the river has sustained Egyptian civilizations for thousands of years. The problem for Egypt is that this life-giving artery flows about 6,000 kilometers and through 9 countries before it reaches Aswan. Egypt is therefore first and foremost a downstream country, highly vulnerable, and in a geopolitical position exploited by foreign powers in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. Our journey up the Nile starts on the terrace of the venerable Old Cataract Hotel, opened by the British in 1902, 20 years after they occupied Egypt. It's hardly likely that the tourists consider, while admiring the river at sunset, its geopolitical importance. How the Nile links one-tenth of the enormous African continent and hundreds of millions of people in a commonality fraught with conflict, and how it can help us to understand what could happen in other large river basins. The Nile, like most great rivers, cares nothing for national frontiers. Along such rivers, there are conflicting interests between different countries and different users. But there are few, if any, countries so dependent on a resource they do not themselves control, as is Egypt. This boat was used in the shooting of the film Death on the Nile. But more dramatic than any Agatha Christie murder story is the story of the struggle for control of the Nile, and the diplomatic intrigues surrounding it are more complex. Many of the 20th century's foremost politicians, among them Churchill and Mussolini, Eisenhower and Eden, Khrushchev and Nasser, have used the Nile as a bargaining counter in a strategic game fraught with grave regional and international consequences. When the scramble for Africa was at its height, the British took control over Egypt. They turned the country into a giant cotton plantation, partly to supply Britain's own textile industry. The cotton fields increased the need for water, but the Nile in Egypt was not sufficient in low water season. London sought, therefore, political and hydrological control of the river upstream of Egypt. This would also safeguard Britain's control of the Suez Canal in competition with other European rivals. In the mid-1890s, the British occupied what is now Uganda. Their main object was to bring the headwaters of the Nile under London's control. Although this lake was enormous, about the size of Scotland, it had only been first seen by Europeans some decades earlier. After America had been discovered, the geographical secret that most intrigued an expanding Europe was the source of the Nile. As far back as Nero's day, attempts had been made to find it. The Roman emperor dispatched his soldiers up the Nile by boat, but like the expeditions that followed them, they were halted by the enormous swamps of southern Sudan. In the late 1850s, two Britons, Richard Burton and John Henry Speke, set out on a long and rigorous journey on foot from the coast of East Africa to the heart of what in those days was known as the Dark Continent. Speke reached the lake on the 30th of July 1858. He named it Lake Victoria after his queen. Speke was the first European to see the main source of the White Nile. This monument marks an important milestone in the European nation's scramble for Africa in general, and the Nile Valley in particular. Once the British had secured control of Lake Victoria, they had bigger ambitions than to patrol the lake with a fleet of canoes, which had been an important part of the military force of the Buganda king in the past. London immediately made plans for giant dams at these Central African lakes. The aim was to increase Egypt's cotton production and to give London political control of Egypt's lifeline. In the event, however, it was not until 1954 that a dam, much smaller than the one originally envisaged, was built. Egyptian nationalists were so suspicious of what London had in mind upstream that it was only after decades of negotiation that Cairo finally assented to the project, in return for the right to station two engineers on site to ensure that no Nile water was diverted elsewhere and used for purposes other than the generation of electricity. London had sent its colonial army and its Maxim guns to Uganda in the 1890s, mainly because Lake Victoria was regarded as the prime source of the Nile, and therefore also a potential stick and carrot vis-a-vis Egypt. This story can show how countries in a river basin are linked together by historical developments. What happens upstream will always have an impact on what happens downstream, and what happens downstream will influence developments upstream. It's a kind of forced marriage from which nobody can really escape. Let's hope states will, in the future, choose cooperation instead of conflict. The character of the Nile led the British, in the late 1890s, to occupy another upstream country, the Sudan, and hence they marched towards Khartoum. In 1896, they built a railway through one of the hottest deserts in the world to help them in their bloody campaign, so graphically described by Winston Churchill in his The River War. The railway is still in use. The British had no real interest in controlling the desert. They were, however, bent on turning the gifts of the Nile to the benefit of the British Empire. They knew that to dam Lake Victoria alone was useless. The reason was clear. The river in the southern Sudan could not, in its natural state, bring more water to the north. The White Nile lost half of its water in the swamp. The British therefore planned a 360 kilometers long canal to bring more water to the north. To do this, military control was necessary. The Africans living with their cattle on the banks of the Nile found themselves caught up in a world political maelstrom. At the end of the 1970s, the governments of Egypt and the Sudan decided that the old British plans, with modifications, should be carried out. This time, the plan was stopped by a regional war. In 1983, the Sudan People's Liberation Army attacked the canal builders. The rebels supported the canal as such, but demanded a price that was not accepted: more water for the south. Once again, the plan which was first suggested in 1899 is back on the drawing board, awaiting peaceful conditions. Ethiopia, the land of Lake Tana and the Blue Nile, may safely be termed Africa's water tower. The Blue Nile Falls is not only a tourist attraction where it leaves the lake, it can also illustrate that almost 90% of all the Nile's waters come from Ethiopia. The British were not interested in occupying this old Christian empire. One reason was that their experts knew that the Ethiopian river carried vast quantities of silt, which made it difficult to dam, and that the floodwater came pouring down in the autumn, at a time of year when there was no need for extra water. Since they were not romantic empire builders, the British leaders were able to safeguard their Nile strategy by diplomatic means. They sought an agreement with the Ethiopian emperor, by which the emperor allegedly promised not to take any water from the Nile without the prior consent of London. Today, people ask whether this agreement is still binding. Ethiopia has now far-reaching plans to exploit the river for much more ambitious purposes than as a source of drinking water. Let us hope that future generations will be able to work out agreements that pay heed both to Ethiopia's demands and to the obvious needs of the desert countries downstream. One thing is certain: the past weighs on the present and on the future. Paddling on Lake Tana gives ample time to reflect on British strategies for the lake and the river, and the dramatic, though little-known role the lake has played in international politics. Control of the sources of the Blue Nile should confer control over Egypt downstream, the British hoped. They hoped to use this as a means of inducing the Egyptians to dance to their tune, and at the same time of watering their new cotton plants in the Sudan, the world's largest cotton field. For as Egypt became increasingly anti-British, London shifted the weight of its cotton production to the Sudan. Large-scale cotton growing now made the damming of Lake Tana an urgent issue. The Egyptians protested. They feared that the dam would give the British the power to turn the tap off, their very lifeline. The British found themselves with only one alternative. In the 1920s and 30s, they entered into a series of secret agreements with the new fascist leader in Italy, Mussolini. In 1936, Italy invaded Ethiopia. Mussolini got his African colony, and Lake Tana was now under his control. The Ethiopian emperor was forced into exile and appealed to the League of Nations for support. Democrats demanded that the League impose strong sanctions on Italy, but the British government refused. They hoped that Mussolini would honour his secret pledges to London and allow the British finally to build the dam. But Mussolini hoodwinked the British. He rejected London's claim, knowing the strategic importance the British put on the dam. The Second World War was approaching, and he refused to give London what they wanted. After the Second World War, the geopolitical situation was entirely changed, but the importance of the Suez Canal was greater than ever. Nearly all Europe's oil was shipped through the canal, and in Egypt, Arab nationalists had taken power. President Nasser, Egypt's new leader, thought it very important to control the Nile within the frontiers of Egypt. He wanted to construct a gigantic new dam in Egypt. But the British and the American government suddenly went back on their promise to help. Nasser reacted by nationalizing the Suez Canal. He was adamant: Egypt should control both the Nile and the canal. The Suez crisis erupted. The British and French government sent in armed forces, but this military intervention was short-lived, and London suffered political humiliation. the days of the British Nile Empire were over. Conflicts among the Nile states, however, did not end. Nasser and his countrymen got their dam. Even the poor farmers got electricity, and vast new areas of desert were placed under cultivation. And while in the 1890s the population numbered only 4 million, now more than 60 million people live and work on the banks of the Nile in Egypt. This monument beside the Aswan Dam testifies to the conviction that at long last Egypt had become master of the Nile and Egyptians masters of their destiny. The 1959 Nile Agreement for the full utilization of the Nile was an agreement between only two countries. Egypt got the right to two-thirds of the flow and the Sudan the rest. Egypt's future, as far as water was concerned, seemed secure. Today, that belief seems like a naive dream. The upstream states oppose existing agreements. Since the water comes from their territories, and they also need more water for their development, they regard present arrangements as unfair. But the problem has no simple moral or political answer. The desert countries deserve the water they can get. What is obvious, therefore, is that wisdom, knowledge, and goodwill will be needed in the years to come if serious clashes are to be averted. This part of Africa is already home to many terrible wars. A water war among states would be even more ugly. The scarcity of water is a ticking time bomb all through the Middle East too, not least in the Jordan Basin. It has been said that within a few generations, the Dead Sea may disappear altogether. When Yasser Arafat could finally return to Palestine after 10 years in exile, he insisted on staying at this hotel, in the belief that it still stood beside the lake. A few years ago, the Dead Sea was divided in two, and it was possible to cross it dry-shod. It lies some 400 meters below sea level, at the lowest point on the Earth's surface, and is one of the most saline lakes in the world. It's fed mainly by the River Jordan and has no outlet. This results in high concentrations of salts and minerals in a unique composition that is particularly rich in chloride salts of magnesium, sodium, potassium, calcium, and bromine. In addition, alluvial deposits from the much-valued Dead Sea mineral mud, also known as Dead Sea therapeutic black mud. This makes it popular as a place for healing baths, but prospects for the lake and its health look bleak. The reason is that the River Jordan is being exploited at a rate that in the long term is unsustainable. The Zionist leaders declared, long before the State of Israel was established in 1948, that the economic foundations of a Jewish state would be laid by irrigation engineers. The extent of the Jewish home would be determined by how much land could be artificially watered, and they defined the boundaries of their future state in hydrologic terms. From the very first day, the slogan was, "The desert shall bloom." New settlements and kibbutzim called for artificial irrigation with water from the Jordan, augmented by groundwater, then as now. In the 1960s, the Israelis constructed the National Water Carrier, a canal to carry water from the Jordan in the north all the way down through Israel to the Negev Desert in the south. The Arab states bordering the river saw this as tantamount to a declaration of war, but there was little they could do. Compared with the world's principal rivers, the Jordan is no more than a stream. 200 kilometers long, In the course of a year, it carries no more water than the Nile does in 19 hours on a normal September day. At Allenbury Bridge on the Jordanian frontier, the river known to the Arabs as the watering place is just a salty stream. Israel's consumption of water has continued to increase, despite the government's repeated pleas for moderation. Shortly before the outbreak of the Six-Day War in 1967, Israel was using more than 80% of the potential water resources it then possessed. The war gave the Israelis control over more groundwater on the west bank of the Jordan. Israel has developed a truly impressive irrigation system. But the green pastures cannot disguise the fact that with water consumption far higher than its neighbors, the country is verging on crisis. The water resources in the whole of the region are declining. Both Jordan and Syria, via the Yarmouk, as well as Israel, pump water from the River Jordan. The whole area thus faces the threat of water shortage. Israeli politicians argue that land is negotiable, water is not. The late King Hussein of Jordan publicly stated in the 1990s that the only thing that could spark off a war between Jordan and Israel was water. In the early 1990s, Jordan and Israel came to an understanding over water resources. And the agreement has acted as a substitute for an integrated and comprehensive agreement among all the riparians in the Jordan River Basin, leaving out the Palestinians. The issue revolves around the Palestinians' right to water, both from the Jordan and groundwater resources. The Palestinians already have a water crisis. Few people have such a low per capita consumption of water. The water level in their wells is dropping. They have to apply to the Israeli authorities for permission to drill for water trapped in the reservoirs beneath the West Bank. Only a few such rights have been granted since 1967. Nor are the Palestinians allowed to sink such deep wells as the Israelis are. The water reservoirs from which their water comes are controlled by Israel. The Israeli government is afraid that if the Palestinians control the groundwater, Israel, who now take the lion's share, will get less. Economic development of the Palestinian area meets many obstacles, but a fundamental one is insufficient water. The Israelis will not allow them more because Israel doesn't have enough for its own needs. There are many reasons for conflict in the Middle East. Water is certainly one of them. All over the world, a bitter battle is already raging to decide how international rivers should be controlled and exploited. The United Nations has not so far managed to establish a binding legal framework. The UN has convened a series of meetings and conferences aimed at framing regulations for exploitation of multinational watercourses. But behind even the best and most effective bureaucratic solution, there will be little power to back it up. The documents accruing from these proceedings are many and voluminous, but the countries concerned have evinced little interest in adopting clearly defined laws and procedures. In the General Assembly and on the Security Council sit representatives of both upstream and downstream nations. No binding international agreement exists in regard to the use to which multinational watercourses may be put. Lacking is the necessary political will. By themselves, diplomacy and bureaucracy can do little as long as political attitudes remain unchanged. Perhaps the world can learn from some well-established forums for solving water disputes, as in a city on the Spanish east coast. The plain surrounding Valencia is the center of the oldest irrigation-based agricultural community in Europe. It was created by the Romans and Arabs more than 1,000 years ago. In the first half of the 20th century, the cultivated area under artificial watering in the world nearly doubled. Between 1950 and 2000, it more than doubled again. The limit has probably now been reached. It is thus a global problem, how water should be apportioned between countries, sectors, and users. In a square in Valencia stands one of the fountains built to symbolize the importance of the 8 large canals outside the city. Here too stands the ancient cathedral. Outside the door, chairs have been set out. Representatives of the 8 canals are about to meet to hear complaints. The chairs are for the lay judges. For over 1,000 years, at 12:05 every Thursday morning, a court has assembled here. Denunciados de la sequía de Rascaña. This woman has reported a firm of contractors. They have not appeared.
Està 4 mesos entaronjat sense veure. Per més que es diem, no fan cas. Perquè farà més i mitja nit i per li l'encarregat. Me feu molt bones raons, però molt mal fets. Perquè el taronger, vostès crec que ho comprendran, s'està rullant la fulla. És que té set. No, anem a deixar-lo morir. Crec que me parle bé. Donarem pas pels de baix. I jo, que l'au ja havia passat per el meu camp, a mi no m'han donat res. El diumenge anaré. Les boques, que vostès ho entenen, no les han ficat a la mateixa medida de les altres. Les han ficat el doble. Jo crec que no hi ha 38. I 4 dits més baixes.
Ja se pot retirar? Ja, eh?
Hòstia, Clara.
Denunciats, ara sí que de rascalla.
Jo tinc que citar-lo també.
A mi? Jo cal que el citar.
Denunciats, ara sí que de rovella.
Ja ho sé.
Tinc que anar.
Denunciats de la sequía de Rovella.
In this manner, people have been voicing their complaints here for generations ever since the Moors ruled Spain. In those days, they gathered in the mosque. Now they meet outside the cathedral at the apostle's door. The proceedings are oral. The judges are elected by the farmers themselves, and decisions are handed down almost immediately in order that the crops should not suffer. Perhaps Valencia's water court and its traditions can serve as a lesson to other areas in the world where water is scarce. This journey through the history of water comes to an end in the Oman desert. This is one of the hottest and most arid places on Earth. Despite this, for thousands of years, Oman has been one of the principal agricultural areas in the Arabian Peninsula. All cultivation presupposes artificial irrigation. Here, no farm is watered by rain. So little rain falls that the Bedouins call water life. Their word for rain is the same as that for life. As in the Sahara, the nomads say, rain is the widow's brother and the orphan's father. The modern irrigation plots form sharply delineated green islets in the desert sand. New plants pump up groundwater. They threaten the very impressive ancient irrigation system, which for thousands of years has given rise to one agricultural settlement after another. The water on which the oasis depends is rainwater that has accumulated underground on the mountainside for centuries. Legend has it that Solomon, David's son, came to Oman on a flying carpet. His attendant jinns, spirits, built 10,000 such canals in 10 days. We know that this long, deep canal was constructed some 2,500 years ago by the Persians. Here in Nizwa, some 10 to 20 meters below ground, time has stood still. To walk here is to follow the long course of the city's history. Farmers gather beneath the palms for a water auction, as they have done for generations. The mainstay of the community is about to be portioned out. Surplus water can be sold by those with shares in the various canals. Water is sold in athars, an athar being a unit of time. It has been determined by measuring the shadow thrown by a stick during the day or by recording the movement of the stars at night. The Omani name for the canal system comes from the verb to share, to divide up a property into shares. In many ways, the farmers who own shares in such a canal system constitute a community of their own. The way in which shares are apportioned and the system operates is highly complex and varied. The rule is that the joint owners possess a collective right to some of the water. Drinking water is drawn from the mother well, that is, from the source of the canal or its first exit. Lower down, bathing is permitted. Is this local water auction in Nizwa, which has been going on more or less unchanged for hundreds of years, an augury of future regional water exchanges, bourses, and a global water market? Will pipelines span the desert, carrying water from regions where it abounds to those where it is in short supply, the way oil is now pumped over vast distances? And will countries blessed with water in abundance be the oil sheiks of the future? Water is truly a global issue. It's a resource on which everyone and everything depends, and which no one can do without, and which all must share. The water I'm drinking here in the Oman desert may once have been in the stomach of an Inuit on Greenland, or filled the baths of a Roman emperor or of Arab traders. It may have been in a Pepsi downed by Michael Jackson, a perfume bottle used by Marilyn Monroe, or the poisoned chalice drunk by Socrates. Water is constantly in motion, which means it cannot be the property of any one place. Water circulation is a link between times past, present, and future. What we do with it now will thus be of decisive importance to the future of us all.